Good evening. My name is Ron Gilson. I'm the Myers Professor of Law and Business at the Law School, and I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our program this evening, The Modern State Attorney General, Power, Influence, and Ethics. I want to take just about two sentences to frame some of the issues that we'll talk about tonight. Practicing lawyers, those in the audience know this, are subject to a complex web of rules of professional responsibility that govern conflicts of interest, the responsibility, the prominence of the responsibility of their clients. State attorney generals are lawyers, and they act on behalf of their clients, that is, the citizens of their state. In that sense, they operate just like the rest of us. The difficulty is that
The difficulty of that is that they are also unavoidably acting in a political environment. They have to run for office. This is the same environment that legislators confront in every state, but the difference is that legislators aren't acting as lawyers. The result is that the plate tectonics, the tensions that result from the rules of professional responsibility on the one hand and the reality and the perfectly understandable realities of the political system on the other, when they rub up against each other, they create tensions. And those tensions are a lot of what we're going to look at tonight. Let me do only one introduction. Nora Engstrom, who's going to moderate the panel. Nora is a professor at the law school and a distinguished expert in professional responsibility. I'm going to turn it over to her.
Thank you, Ron, and thank you for being here today. I'll introduce our panelists, and then I'm going to open it up briefly, or I'm going to have them talk for about 5 minutes to give us some background on today's panel, and then I'll have some questions, and then we'll reserve about 20 minutes where hopefully you'll have some questions for our panelists. Our first panelist, you might notice, is not here, although he is on his way. So he got tied up in the bad weather that hit the SFO airport today, but I understand his plane has landed and he's in a car, and he will be joining us shortly. But Terry Goddard is the former Arizona Attorney General. He served as the Attorney General of Arizona from 2003 to 2010. During a period when he addressed major issues ranging from the fallout of the Great Recession and the 2008 mortgage crisis to issues involving border smuggling and money laundering and many others. In addition, Terry was the Democratic nominee for the governor of Arizona in 2010. Next, we have Jim Tierney here on the end, who served as the Attorney General of Maine from 1980 through 1990. He is now the director of the National State Attorneys General Program at Columbia Law School, where he teaches classes on the role of the state AG. And he's serving this year as a lecturer on law at Harvard Law School, where he is bringing his expertise to bear there. Finally, we have Eric Lipton right to my right. He is a Washington-based correspondent for the New York Times, where he writes about government relations, corporate agendas, and Congress. He is a two-time winner of the Pulitzer Prize, and he won most recently in 2015 for a series of articles which provide really the intellectual foundation for today's discussion, which in the words of the Columbia Journalism Review, quote, exposed the hell out of the way corporate America evades accountability. So thank you for braving the weather to be here. And as I said, now we're going to start with 5 to 7 minutes. Jim, if you want to go first, and then Eric, and then hopefully Terry will be here to introduce your area of work in detail, what you believe really are the most pressing challenges now confronting state AGs. So, Jim.
So you want to start with me?
Yeah.
Okay. Can everybody hear me okay? Thanks for having me. You know, the other day, Eric has written this series of articles in New York Times. He covers lobbying. That's what he does. And he does it exceptionally well. And I work very closely with him. I was both an on-the-record and an off-the-record source with Eric throughout his entire effort. The New York Times gets great kudos for putting the resources in to let him do the work that shines light on what I would say is about 5% at most of what attorneys general do. 5% at most of what attorneys general do. There are 13,000 lawyers in this country who work for the attorney general's offices. And no more than 200 are involved in all the articles that he wrote. Because they are back home doing the kind of job that we want them to do. They are involved in prison reform. They are involved in immigration issues. They are dealing with right to choose. They are right to regulating nonprofits. They are making antitrust decisions. They are doing all of these things. Far from the glare and the light of anything that Eric wrote about. So Eric's coverage of the attorneys general in their national forum is an issue certainly appropriate to discuss. But nothing could be more preposterous than whoever this American corporate avoid corporate responsibility, balderdash, poppycock foolishness. And Ron himself, dear friend that he is, misses a very fundamental description when he talks about the attorneys general. He begins by saying you have the mob rules here and you have the politicians here, completely missing the fact that attorneys general are constitutional officers in 48 of the 50 states, not responsible to the executive branch, essential to the functioning and operations of state separation of powers, imbued with the common law, who have a fundamental duty to represent the state, the entire state, as an entity and the people in it, and not particular agencies or functions of them. Now, the case law varies from state to state, and I can take you through any state of your choice, because that's kind of what I do for work. But the basic theory that you would have the model rules here, drafted by private lawyers for private lawyers, and nasty politics over here, is, again, Ron, with all due respects, a preposterous notion. Because in between, you've got assistant attorneys general, and I see more courage in the world of attorneys general every day than I see in the United States Senate, than I see in the Congress, or I see in state legislatures, and believe me, I have wallowed around in all three. I see attorneys general standing up and doing what is right, oftentimes without anybody knowing it, oftentimes at great political peril, and taking positions that I fundamentally disagree with, but doing so from an ethical and construct base based on their reading of the statutes, the common law, and their sense of what's best in the public interest of their states. So that's my kickoff.
Sure. Well, I mean, I completely agree with Jim, and I respect Jim's feelings about that what I wrote about was a small cut of the world of state attorneys general, but it's an important cut of it. It is the bosses. And the bosses have the power to overrule their minions, and what I saw in my reporting was the times that they do that, and what I saw also showed me a world that if you were to compare it to the world of U.S. attorneys and assistant U.S. attorneys, that was very different in terms of the activities that were occurring in the world of state attorney generals versus the kind of the activities that occur in the worlds of U.S. attorneys. So, I mean, how do I switch this thing now? Sorry.
Right as we needed it.
Oh, really?
Let me try to
okay.
Should be down here, but it's not. That's
good. Okay. There we go. Oh, yeah, that's it, yeah. Okay, and now you need to do full screen, sorry. Okay. I got introduced to this topic when a lobbyist in D.C. came to me with this document, and this was the sort of the start of the whole thing. And this document shows that if you give $125,000 to the Republican Attorneys General Association, you get special access. You get to spend the weekend resort retreats with your Republican Attorney Generals, and the DAGA is the Democratic version, and they have a similar operation. And not only that, but you get a monthly phone call from an attorney general. You get to do private presentations to them on your issue. And you get a basically special access to them in exchange for $125,000. And so I got this document, and my boss and I, and the thing about, okay, this kind of thing happens all the time in politics. I mean, you give to, you know, the Bush Rangers, the governors. I mean, they all have their versions of this. But to me, and the thing that struck my boss and I about this was that these people have subpoena power. I mean, these are law enforcement officers. And if you can pay to get access to law enforcement officers at the same time as you're being investigated and potentially influence the outcome of that investigation, that's a very different from making a contribution to a governor or even a president that doesn't have subpoena power, for example. So, I mean, the first thing I did was I unannounced went into a RAGA meeting, and which was a closed meeting, and this is my cell phone. I just took a picture, and Jim knows a lot of the people in this photo. There's the former Attorney General of Florida. Right to his left, got cut off here, is Bernie Nash is over there in the side. And there's Bank of America and the NRA, the J.P. Morgan Chase, and there's Terry Goddard walking in,
the Chase.
Yes, right with Chase, right. I met Jim, I think, at that first meeting. This was in February in Washington.
Not at the RAGA meeting.
No, not the RAGA meeting, but at the
DAGA meeting.
At the DAGA meeting, but the National Association of Attorney General was having a meeting in February in Washington. That and RAGA and DAGA had their own little side events. And I met Jim there at the National Association of Attorney General, which is not doesn't take these kinds of sponsorships. Just very quickly, that this having seen this, we decided to do open records requests in 25 states, and we did using the emails of the lobbyists that I was able to identify. We requested all correspondence between those lobbyists and the attorney generals and their top deputies. And collected, 6,000 to 8,000 pages worth of emails over a matter of months. And I also began to go on the circuit of all these events these are some of the sponsors that Braga pulls in. And basically, I could deconstruct just about every one of these companies and their agenda item that they have and why they're trying to influence the Attorney General, either to get out of either to influence the outcome of an investigation or to enlist them as partners. To lobby Washington or to try to avoid an increase in regulation or to educate them about the potential for becoming a future target of regulation. It was just fascinating to deconstruct those stories. And so I essentially moved into that world for 8 months of 2014 and it consumed my life and ended up writing a three-part series about it. Yes, and winning a prize.
And winning a prize. So let's say welcome to Terry here. And Terry, we're going to just throw him right in. If you could talk to us for 5 to 7 minutes, what you believe, where you come to this topic from, and what you believe are the most pressing challenges now confronting state AGs.
Okay, thank you. And I apologize for blowing in late. American Airlines kept changing their departure time from Phoenix, so it was a nip and tuck operation, but I'm glad to be here and thank you very much. Let me just tackle it from this side. I had the privilege of being Arizona's Attorney General for 8 years during a period of perhaps unique foment, but perhaps not. It seems like the times we have today are almost as active. And just for a general pitch, I'd just like to say that time and the time I've spent since then, almost 5 years now, looking at and working with attorney general's offices around the country, I'm convinced that some of the best legal work and certainly the most exciting cutting-edge legal work in this country right now is happening at the state AG's offices. I don't always agree with the cases they bring, but damn it, they're bringing cases. They're putting their reputations and their lawyers in the courtroom on a daily basis for some very significant issues. And that's certainly more than I can say for the private bar, and it's more than I can say for the Justice Department. So what's happening today legally is at the state AG's office. And the other thing that I was very proud of was the fact that I thought we had a team of people in Arizona that was as good as any law firm in the country. We beat most of the law firms in the country one time or another in terms of our litigation activities, and we took on some of the biggest opponents around, Bank of America, Chase, Wells Fargo, Western Union. These were companies that obviously could afford the best and send it into battle, and we beat every one of them on a variety of issues. So just a plug, I think it's if folks are thinking about either as professors looking for something else to do, our students looking for a challenging career, it's where I think the action is legally today. It's not perfect, and certainly the New York Times series has pointed out some of the weak spots. I used to tell people that they could look at this list when they were in the office and think carefully about exactly why companies were on that list. There's some positive reasons, and there's some just to avoid harm, certainly. But as a lawyer, I always like to know what the other side is thinking. And I never filed a civil case without sitting down and talking with somebody representing the potential defendant. I think that's an important part of what we do. Rag and dagger may just kind of make that a little more accessible. But the bottom line, and I think it's important, and I think this is true of any public office, but it's particularly true of the AG's offices, is the critical thinking is really done on a day-to-day basis. It's very quiet. It's usually in coffee table conversations. It's in the way the office evolves with an attorney general and his staff or her staff. And when a case is filed, it's usually in context of that kind of progression. It's not a big deal. It may seem so to the news. It may seem so to the people who haven't been privy to that conversation and that sort of evolution. But for those of us in the office, it's usually the inevitable consequence of what we've been thinking about for a very long time. And I guess that gets me to elections. In order to make a difference, in order to be there for those day-to-day conversations and to change the course of your office one way or the other, you've got to get elected. And I got to say that today, that's a much more difficult job than it was when I first ran in 2002. And I've had a fair amount of my career in politics of various kinds, and the explosion of cost just since 2010, since Citizens United, is appalling. Just in Arizona, just to give you an example, when I first ran in 2002, both myself and my opponent were what we call clean elections candidates. We both used state funding so that the total amount spent for our two campaigns combined was $800,000 for a statewide election. I know in California that seems laughable. You know, you can't get out of a city council primary for that much money. But for us, it was significant. We could run a campaign statewide for that. In 2010, the campaign for Attorney General ran to $6 million for the two candidates. 2014, it was in excess of $15 million. You get the idea of what's happening here. All of a sudden, you've got a office holder who's a lawyer first, and hopefully they're about justice and running an office right. And all of a sudden, they got to spend an awful lot of their waking time raising money. And what makes it even worse is what I'm engaged in right now, which is the dark money aspects of the big money. The fact that you very often don't know who the contributors are. And now AGs, like all elected officials, have to look over their shoulder with whatever they do, because dark money operations come at you not just at election time, but with apparently ad hominem attacks while you're doing your job. And I think that's the most critical factor that any of these offices are facing right now, is how to deal with the big money, how to survive in an election cycle that is far more expensive than it's ever been by a factor of almost 10 times, and how to deal with anonymous, usually corporate contributions that are trying to influence whether you get elected and how you do your job. So I'd just like to close by saying I think that's the threat that's facing most elected officials, but particularly AGs, who have had the privilege of being somewhat insulated from the thrust and parry of political life. I'm not saying they weren't in it, but for many years, back in the halcyon days when Jim was Attorney General of Maine, you know, you could do the right thing and not have to live with a dark money attack worth millions of dollars. Today, that's a lot more difficult.
All right, so thank you for those opening remarks. And one of the things that's clear is kind of we saw kind of the good, bad, and the ugly of the rise of the state AGs, and that's hopefully we'll focus on all three over the next hour or so. I want to pick up, Terry, on something you said, which is you noted that some of the most exciting legal work in the country is happening right now in state AG's office. You said it's, quote, where the action is today. That strikes me because it's not always been so, right? So for a time, we thought of AG's office as kind of the backwater. But we have undoubtedly seen this surge in power in state AG's offices. So the question is what do we think accounts for the shift, and where is it most in evidence? You want to start with that, Terry?
Well, if I could answer in one word, yeah. It would be tobacco. And Jim is the expert on that, so I would defer to him as to how that evolved. That was before my time as Attorney General. But when a very courageous Attorney General of Mississippi, decided that he would be the first person in history to take on Big Tobacco and win. He was able to recruit eventually a number of other states to join him in that. Eventually, all but what, five, joined the settlement. And suddenly, the AGs of this country had the conviction that they could get together as a force and make a tremendous difference. In Arizona, the tobacco settlement amounts to $100 million a year into our general fund. California, I don't know the number, but I imagine it's many, many times that. That's not incidental. Now, you could argue that it hasn't done what it was supposed to do, which is to help get people off of a tobacco addiction. But it still is a very big number, and AGs did that against a lot of opposition, and some of it from the administration. So they suddenly figured out that they were an independent force of consequence in this country. Since then, multi-state litigation has gone after Big Pharma in a number of ways. Certainly the settlement that I was involved in with the major banks, the five major banks, $25 billion, hopefully went to consumers, although that wasn't true in every state. It was generally the rule. Again, showed that working together, they could have a major impact. So I think that changed the dynamic and made other folks take notice, but also made the attorney generals themselves think about their job, not just in serving the agencies of their state, but in what it meant when they agreed with other states and worked together.
Yeah, let me respond. First of all, assistant attorneys general are not minions. And on behalf of the 12,000 professional lawyers who go to work every day and do their job, they are not minions. And I'm offended by your rather snide remark, Eric. I'll start right off with that. But more important, they're also, Nora, not the backwater. They're the backwater because the law schools that I teach at and the law schools that you teach at and every law professor in America seemingly went to the same five law schools and all focus on federal government and federal law because that's all they care about. And that's what they talk about, that's what they think about, that's what they live and breathe.
But just to be clear, so the point was historically...
That's your history. Yeah. Okay. That's your history. That's not the history of Walter Mondale, who when he was game attorney general 55 years ago in Minnesota, in his very first week in office, got a call from Yale Commissar and said, let's do something about Gideon versus Wainwright, establishes a brief. That's not the backwater. AG offices have not been the backwater. They're only the backwater because when you live in this cocoon, you live in the national press cocoon, you live in the national law school cocoon, and you're not out there worrying about, and now AGs have made good decisions and bad decisions, but if you're talking about child welfare, you're talking about criminal justice, 90% of our prisoners are in the state as a result of state prosecution, state and local prosecution. But if you look at the literature, the academic literature, it's 90% about the 10%. It's all about the federal. No one wants to talk about it. So it's a backwater because you live in New York City or Cambridge or Palo Alto and you don't think about and focus on the fact that the lives of millions, hundreds of millions of American citizens have been impacted by the quality of work that their attorneys general do. Now, part of the problem is when you win, if you're in government, you don't see the results. When you keep a stream from being polluted, nobody knows you did it. When you have a safe neighborhood, nobody knows you did it. That's the nature of government work. Now, during the present time, they're working very closely with the Obama administration, most states, Republican and Democrats. Through this kind of cooperative, because, you know, President Obama is a state guy. As George Herbert Walker Bush, also excellent relationships with the states during his time there because he understood the value of states. President Clinton, first President Clinton, and maybe, I don't know about the second President Clinton, but the first President Clinton certainly did not have much respect for the state from which he came, and his policies were not particularly deferential to state government. Same was also true of George W. Bush. So, but backwater, no. Minions, no. Creative cases, I can tell you a lot of them, but I'm going to give you a break because I'm talking about it.
I agree with both of these guys that suggest that the movement towards the multi-state has changed the standing since tobacco and the movement from tobacco to pharmaceuticals to banks to nonprofit, to for-profit colleges. I mean, it goes across every sector now, the economy. The state attorneys general, because of their pooling of resources and their multi-state efforts, are such a threat to corporate America that that's exactly what has motivated this incredible response by all the lobbyists, because they realize that they could lose, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars to these attorneys general who, acting as individual prosecutors, couldn't really show them down for the most part if they came from a small state which didn't have the investigative resources to take down, you know, the tobacco industry. It's only by pooling all their investigative resources and sometimes hiring, in fact, outside counsel to help them, can they then, you know, challenge the multinational corporation. And so that's exactly what generated this incredible swell of lobbying and money spending. And what Terry is seeing in the explosion of spending is these corporate forces. It's Sheldon Adelson writing the $500,000 check to the Republican Attorney General's Association this year. Is it 500,000, I think? You know, one guy, you know, and he has an agenda as well. He's trying to get the state attorneys general to help him ban online poker so his casinos will do a better job in terms of bringing in revenue because they won't have the threat from online poker. I mean, that's one of the many issues that he's got. And so we're talking about the same thing. I'm looking at the phenomenon that emerged in reaction to it. And the thing that makes the world of state attorney general so interesting is that it's largely unregulated. So I'm a lobbying reporter. In Washington, if you're going to lobby the White House or Congress, you need to register as a lobbyist. You need to say who hired you. You need to say how much you're being paid. You need the special disclosure of your contributions. There's limits on the gifts you can give. Almost none of that exists for lobbying of state attorneys general. I mean, there are none of them are registered. None of them disclose who hired them. You know, none of them say, you know, how much they're paid. There's no revolving door limits on their ability to leave the attorney general office one day and then all of a sudden be lobbying the former people that they hired the next day. And they do that. In Washington State, that happened with Rob McKenna and Brian Moran. And I saw the emails where they were, you know, a few days after they're leaving, they're back lobbying their former colleagues. So that's the part of the world that I began to write about. Go ahead,
okay.
Terry.
Just one point on that, Eric, because the state attorney generals do not follow the federal rule, which is, you seem to imply that they should. They follow the state rules. And so, for instance, I had a freeze-out period. I couldn't lobby anybody in my former office for a year. That was the law in Arizona. And some states require attendance at these meetings to be registered as a lobbyist, and some don't. So there's a 50-state continuum that varies dramatically, sometimes nothing, sometimes very intense scrutiny. So it's not quite clear that none of these lawyers, for the most part, are registered. They are with whatever the state requirement is.
I'm unaware of a single state where there are people who specialize in this work. You talk to the former folks in Dixon Shapiro, they're not registered in any state as lobbyists.
I can't speak for them, but I just registered in Mississippi because I made a single phone call to an assistant attorney general in the Mississippi AG's office. Okay. So it does happen. I don't hammer everybody.
Okay.
All right, so Eric is taking us to a next point, which is, so we've seen, I think Jim, even you would agree, a surge in power for state AGs. And so the first question here is this a positive or a negative development? Now, Eric's point is, as soon as you have a surge in power, then it's a more attractive target, right? And then the folks come, and especially in an unregulated or relatively unregulated atmosphere, there will be even, you know, more attempts to sway state AG's opinions. But let's table that for a moment. Yeah. And tabling
that. Power itself?
Yeah, so
okay.
Thinking about the
let me give you a sense of power itself. By the way, because I get all worked up here, but obviously if I didn't think there were problems, I wouldn't have been talking to you, Eric, through that whole period of time. I'm on the record. I'm a source close to attorneys general. I'm a whatever thing in there, I'm through the whole thing, all right? So, and I think the work he did was fabulous. But it reminds me of the movie Spotlight. Have some of you seen the movie Spotlight? But once a year, my wife and I go to one of these literary things in New York, and it's right out of like some New Yorker movie, and we're there on the Upper West Side. And a producer and a director, very famous, come up to me and say, "What did you think of that movie Spotlight?" I thought it was fabulous. They said, "It was a terrible movie." They were experts, not me. They said they didn't explore the depth of the priest's pedophilia. And I said, that wasn't what the movie was about. movie was about journalism. It wasn't about police, it was about journalism. So what you're hearing here between what probably sounds like tension between me and Eric is, we're watching different movies, okay? He's watching the lobbyist movie. He's watching all these people coming in and asking for more, you know, fewer regulation. Actually, a lot of them are asking for more regulation on their competition, as you pointed out with Sheldon Adelstein. But the point is, where does this come from? This doesn't come really from tobacco, in my judgment. I've studied this a long time. It comes from the integration of the American economy and the world economy. So when I was Attorney General long decades ago, I brought lawsuits against pharmacies for different things they did, but they were all locally owned. So today, if that pharmacy in Maine does something that the Attorney General of Maine wants to do something about, guess what? They're doing it in California, they're doing it in Texas, they're doing it in Minnesota, because the local pharmacy is the same pharmacy. It's all Walgreens, it's Walmart, it's Rite Aid, whatever it is, okay? And so naturally, why would an assistant attorney general of Maine not shoot an email off to his or her counterpart in any of those other states and say, is Rite Aid doing this in your state? And they say, I don't know, let's check. So the same efficiencies that drive the consolidation and the same concentration of wealth that drive the consolidation on the economic also gives to the attorney general the chance to leverage back against them. So the rise in power, my theory, Nora, nobody's ever written it, it's just my theory, is that it really doesn't come from, and is it good or bad? I'd say the question's irrelevant because it is. It is what it is. We're not going to unscramble the eggs. We're not going to be able to somehow go back to family-owned pharmacies in Maine. That's not the way it's going to work. So we are where we are, and we're living where we live. And so the AGs have more power, nowhere near as much power as they think they do, nowhere near as much power as their lobbyists are telling their clients that the AGs have, because it's in the economic interest of the lobbying industry to tell them, oh, the AGs are coming, the AGs are coming. I mean, I could tell a horror story. I mean, it's a preposterous nature of things that the lobbyists say, desperate for business, will try to frighten their own clients. Clients are afraid. They don't know. Why? Because they read Eric Lipton's articles. And so here we go. We're in the circular routine here of AGs, I think, taking a rap for being more powerful than they are. They have no incentive to say we're really not that powerful, right? What AG would do that? They would say, yes, I'm very powerful. I mean, so we have a lot of this.
Whatever it is you were talking about.
Yeah, whatever it is, I'm very powerful. I'm an expert on that. Why? Because the politicians, comes back to Ron's point. So I'm probably bouncing around a little bit. But we are watching kind of different movies, and that's what I meant to say. Eric is the national leader for the movie on lobbying, and we're not just talking about the Attorney General, the work he has done on the Congress, where evidently they solved all their problems by these discovery rules that you're talking about? All the lobbying problems in Washington solved by these federal rules? No.
It gives me a different kind of visibility.
It gives you great visibility. So you have no incentive for all the lobbying to go perfectly. Nobody does. So we're all kind of wrapped up in the same sort of package.
let me jump in here.
Go ahead. I'm talking too much.
My theory is talent. One of the things the multi-states has also done is unleashed relatively small states that have some terrific assistant attorney generals who become specialists.
Yes.
Case in point, Julie Brill, currently on the Federal Trade Commission, was an assistant AG in Vermont. She became the consumer protection expert for the nation because she could get on the phone on a biweekly basis with her counterparts in states all across the country and tee up a new issue, which she had seen, or maybe some of them had seen. And the first thing you know, they've gotten together, they've got a working group, and they've issued investigative demands on that particular topic. It made a tremendous difference because, again, the Justice Department wasn't doing that kind of investigations.
Right.
The states couldn't before, but together they had the collective power and the talent base to be able to do it. And so Iowa, for example, a small state, has one of the great attorney generals in the nation and one of the great staffs, because people have sought out Tom Miller as a place to make their mark as lawyers. And I think that's becoming more and more prevalent.
And look, I only have my one show. I get a whole semester of this at my other school, so I have to squeeze it in here for 1 hour. This president is very, very friendly with AGs. I mean, former AGs, your chancellor, Janet Napolitano, your former attorney general, Ken Salazar, Tom Perez, who is the Secretary of Labor, Julie Brill's on the Federal Trade Commission. But below that, This administration has cherry-picked assistant AGs from all over the country. So if you go today to the FCC, you find the head of enforcement, the former chief deputy attorney general here in California. So you go to these issues, and the integration of this administration and state attorneys general and running is a level of sophistication. Do not, because it's not written down in an article, if there are any students watching out there, if it's not written down in an article, doesn't mean it isn't true. The interrelationship, the context, and the most classic example of this is Barack Obama, when he was a state senator, his seatmate was none other than Lisa Madigan, who's now the Attorney General of Illinois. So try to put a face on this. It means that when State Senator Obama brings little Sasha and Malia to bring a daughter to work day, right? And he has to take a phone call, little Sasha Maria, climb up into the lap of then State Senator Lisa Madigan, okay? That's the kind of closeness that we're talking about here. There is a repeat factor that we're a country with 300 million people is not so big that we do not have personal relationships, that phone calls get made, that context get made, that people have credibility. And so if you have a brilliant assistant AG in Vermont, he or she can be a very powerful person in this country. It's one of the great glories of federalism.
All right, so let's turn now. We talked about Eric's movie. Let's turn to Eric's movie. So we've talked about it some, right? These series of articles in 2014, won the Pulitzer last year. To write the articles, poured through some 6,000 emails obtained through open records laws from 24 states, conducted hundreds of interviews. And so, Eric, obviously this reporting made great waves. Can you just, for those who might not be familiar with what exactly you found, you gave us some idea, can you walk folks through the five or six things that you found most interesting, that you found most shocking, that surprised you the most?
I mean, I have a couple of documents that I pulled out that I'm going to share with you guys just to give some sense of it. But some of the things that I found is the access to the front office in resort settings away from your staff, and the opportunity for representatives for corporations to set up, you know, meetings in which they could change the course of investigations. I mean, for example, at the Santa Monica Hotel, the Attorney General from Missouri was there, and representatives from 5-Hour Energy and AT&T encounter him there. And these are lawyers who were contributors to his campaign, and questioned why his state had joined a multi-state investigation of those two companies. It's completely unrelated investigations. He says he's unaware of those investigations, and in the course of that same weekend, calls back to his office and has his state pull out of those two investigations. Although he ultimately still participated in a settlement with AT&T over cramming, but no longer was a lead in the multi-state, and completely took himself out of the 5-Hour Energy matter. And so to me, I don't understand why you could create a situation where, in particularly in Dag and Rag, I'm not talking about the National Associations of Attorneys General, but where you can pay, you know, tiered amounts of money to get special access, in which you then have the opportunity to interact and spend an entire weekend with your state attorney general of choice. And so, I mean, this is, you know, here we have an email, which I'm not sure why that side thing is there, just cutting off the email. But this is, I mean, an example of an email that came through, and I mean, there's so many emails that I got, but in the middle of negotiations with Dixie and Shapiro and the J.B. Kelly, who's formerly the deputy attorney general from,
North Carolina,
he's a very nice guy, and writes to Joe Dandaran, who's the deputy attorney general in Missouri at the time, and they're literally in the midst of investigations over a Pfizer fraud matter, misbranding of a drug, and he writes Koster's deputy to ask if Koster wants to come to Chicago and to a packed breakfast, and that Pfizer are very, very excited and appreciative to hear from him. And as you come down, you can see that this is a conference. We'd love to hear from the relationships can help to efficiently address AG's questions and concerns before they escalate into major problems, as well as how they can carry over when AGs are elected to higher office. And so this, I mean, literally, this is March, and then we, 27th, April 2nd. The same firm as Bernie Nash has done in his office. Can I call you now? Thanks for the meeting. Pfizer is pleased. They've just settled the case. I mean, within a matter of days. Days after, they just invited him to come to Chicago to the PAC. And then I did an analysis of all the settlements on that same fraud case in every state that filed that same matter. And I examined the per capita amount of money that Missouri got. And Missouri got a much smaller payment. If you look, you know, the state below it, Maryland, got $1.5 million. The state above it, population-wise, got $1.1 million. And Missouri got $750,000. So it got, you know, and so, you know, what's going on here? You know, now the Missouri Attorney General offered an explanation to me that they had missed the multi-state deadline, which he never announced publicly, and that they were in a box and they had to settle for less money. Although then when I spoke with the one other state, Oregon, that did not do the multi-state, they got a much bigger settlement even than any of these states. So, you know, this is another example, which we'll start and I'll go quickly. But here's an email from J.B. Kelly, again from Dick Stein Shapiro, which is sort of, Bernie Nash himself calls himself the godfather of the lobbying of the state attorney general, Dick Stein Shapiro. They all left Dick Stein Shapiro, they're now at Cozen O'Connor. So here is J.B. Kelly writing a bunch of his colleagues from the AG world saying, Brian Brand's leaving the Washington State Attorney General's office. He was the deputy at Washington State. You know, why don't you join us for drinks? So that was a bunch of the AGs and the deputies that were all going to go out for drinks. So this is June of 2013, okay? And now here it is July, a month later. And now Brian Moran is writing emails to his former office in Washington State on behalf of Microsoft. And T-Mobile, along with Rob McKenna, who was the former attorney general, and he's lobbying them to try to convince them on a Microsoft-related matter. This has to do with the T-Mobile has to do with the merger between they're trying to. At the moment, actually, I forget the specifics of what the cases were, honestly, but. These are people that used to work for these guys, and it's only a month later, and now he's basically writing all his former deputies on behalf of the corporations that they were actually then pursuing just a month earlier, and he's been hired now to represent them. And here's another example that I'm going to stop. This is a lawsuit that's pending in federal court right now where Google is suing Mississippi, and it's also suing a number of law firms, including Oracle, to try to force them to produce documents because it's arguing that Oracle was not representing Google as a law firm. It was representing them as a lobbying firm. And so therefore, it's not entitled to privilege. And it's suing the Mississippi Attorney General's office because it's arguing that there was essentially a conspiracy between Microsoft and the Motion Picture Association to use the Mississippi Attorney General's office as a tool to go after Google and its search engine. And if you look at some of the allegations, and this is the pending case which hasn't been decided in federal court right now, in the midst of the Sony hack, one of the things that came out, and I wrote a story about this, was the fact that the MPAA and their lawyers were writing, they wrote the subpoena that the Mississippi Attorney General then sent to Google. There are drafts of that subpoena in the MPAA's and Sony's emails. And then they were essentially issuing, they hired Mike Moore, who is the former attorney general from Mississippi, who's the guy that started the whole tobacco thing, as their lobbyist. And Mike Moore runs Jim Hood's campaigns and helps him raise money. And then Mike Moore was working for Microsoft to try to go after Google. And Mike Moore was then being used. I mean, it's just, you know, this is all, we're talking about law enforcement here, and there's none of this is disclosed. No one would know that any of this existed until I got all these emails. And all this is going on behind the scenes, and that the MPAA and their lawyers wrote the subpoena that then was sent to Google. I mean, that doesn't seem right to me. So that's some of the stuff that came out to me. And this is actually the last one. I'm sorry. Another thing that became apparent to me was the alliance between the energy corporations, Devon Energy, which is a huge natural gas company, Continental Resources, another natural gas company, the Southern Company, which is one of the largest coal-burning power plant companies in the United States, and a certain number of the AGs, most of them Republicans, and challenging the EPA to try to force back the EPA and clean air rules and clean water rules. So Devon Energy there is one of the biggest contributors to the Republican Attorney General's Association. In the email correspondence that I got from the state of Oklahoma, all of a sudden there were all these emails saying, "Would you mind, you know, challenging this regulation? We think it's a bad regulation." And all the, as I mentioned, the journalism class I was in earlier today, all the attachments were missing. Okay, in, you know, all the attachments to the emails were missing. So here's the draft of the letter. They did all of a sudden the Oklahoma Attorney General, somehow the attachments, we can't find them. I said, "I'm sorry, I asked for the attachments as well. I'd like the attachments." And so after several more weeks of pushing them, "You're the chief freedom of information officer, it's your state, it's your responsibility to produce this information just like you tell all the other state agencies they must produce." And so finally he gave me the attachments. Okay, so this is the draft letter from Devon Energy that they wanted the Oklahoma Attorney General to send to the EPA to object to a rule. We counted it up, the entire letter is 1,016 words. This is the letter he sent, 37 words were different. And we found like a dozen of these letters that he was sending to the EPA, the Department of Interior, to President Obama, in which he was intervening. And then we also found briefs, and some of which were submitted to the Supreme Court, that were being written by the corporations and then being taken by the attorneys general, and submitted as their comment either in court proceedings or in comment letters, formal regulatory comment letters. And these are the same corporations that were contributing hundreds of thousands of dollars in unregulated contributions to RAGA and DAGA, and mostly to RAGA. That's influencing the process. And while it represents just, you know, maybe 5% of what the attorneys general do, it's an important 5%. Until I did this work, much of it was invisible to the public.
You want to heard of an unregulated contribution before? That's a term of art.
Unregulated to the extent you can give as much as you want to RAGA and DAGA. And
then, you meant not, yes, not subject to.
Yes. I'm doing. Do you want to comment? I've got some thoughts.
Back to my original point. I mean, one of the things that we're dealing with here is the explosion of the cost of campaigning, and these guys are pragmatists. They're trying to be in office, and to do that, you've got to get in office and stay there. I really, and you've got some excellent points, and I'm not here to defend General Pruitt. I am here to defend General Hood, however. This is one of the most singularly courageous of the AGs. He's the one who brought the case against the Mississippi murderer, 40 years after the murders took place? That was not a popular thing to do in Mississippi. Jim Hood is an amazing, amazing attorney general, an amazing guy. And he operates against Google with one of the smallest staffs in the country and one of the toughest state lobbying registration programs, as I mentioned earlier, that anybody has to deal with. So if you think the answer is better lobbying registration, you just have to go to Mississippi and see how they do it. Apparently you don't think it works, but they are very tough on the state continuum in terms of registration and doing all that stuff.
I think Nora's going to get to some reforms I have many ideas for reforms, but because clearly there are some problems. But let's not pull this out of context. I mean, lobbyists write speeches for congressmen and senators all the time. Judges ask parties to submit findings of fact, conclusions of law, all the time. The difference is, of course, that this is done secretly. I take your point. But it's done all the time. And I even heard a rumor. I may be wrong. But I actually heard a rumor that Justice Scalia went fishing with somebody. I think it was the Vice President of the United States. And that was okay. So as we pull these issues out, and thank God you're doing it, I've praised you many times. The transparency is good and it's appropriate and lays the groundwork for reform. Let us not lose the context within which we all function here. That the name of the game for Eric is to bring transparency to lobbying. The name of the game for the Attorney General is to get something done. Okay? To get something done. That's why people get into an AG's office, they don't leave. It is the most exciting work that you're going to do. And it wouldn't be so bad, in my humble opinion, if a few more academics did that. My dear friend and colleague Tim Wu at Columbia has taken the year off to work at the New York AG's office and reports to me, never has he had such a satisfying work experience, and that he will teach completely differently as a result of this experience. He's halfway through. He's supposed to be a semester. He's going to take another semester. it doesn't, the dean, he's going to have to go back to teach antitrust. But the point is, if you get out there and do stuff and really want to have something come out the door as opposed to beat the drum, the AGs, for all of their problems, are part of the issue, and it's why they're attracting the lobbying attention. It's why they're attracting the lobbying attention, because they're people who can actually do something. And as a matter of fact, many lobbyists who lobby Washington are having their fees cut and getting laid off, because why should a corporation bother to hire a lobbyist for Congress? Because they don't do anything. And it's absolutely true, because I get these phone calls. They call me up. I had a former U.S. senator come to me recently, who was also a former AG, and say, you know, there really isn't much to do on the congressional side, but what can we, can you help me? Of course I did, because I help everybody. So let's not kid ourselves here. There is a lobbying industry. More and more law firms are into it across the board. You want to service your clients in all aspects of what they do. All four of us here have big law ties. Many of you have big law ties. That's just the way it works. So, well said, Eric. Point well taken. Point to reform. But let's not lose track of where we are.
I want to ask just one follow-up about your reactions to Eric's piece, which is, did anything surprise you?
Sure. Eric found out great stuff. I don't know how you made it. He had a wife, had a baby in the middle of this. I mean, what'd you say you read, 6,000 emails? Yeah. Okay, everybody, let's go home and read 6,000 emails this year. I mean, this is, of course we were surprised. I was surprised at all kinds of things. I didn't know about the Raga, you didn't even get to the Raga plane trips. I didn't know about the Raga plane trips. Those were very revealing, and it brought a lot of transparency and well-deserved credit. It's just not, what the connection doesn't happen, though, is between the lobbying piece and the make something happen piece. Because there is a level of attack on the institution which implies that justice isn't being done all over the place because of this lobbying. That's an open question. It also depends on what your philosophy is, right? So you pointed out that Missouri got less money. Well, that's up to Missouri. The rest of the state seems to do pretty well in that settlement. I mean, I don't know anything about that particular settlement. And the Attorney General of Missouri might just say that maybe his priority should be in Ferguson and not fooling around with lawsuits against 5-hour energy drink. Maybe he thought that's more important. And maybe all of us say, oh, no, you spend more time on 5-hour energy drink than Ferguson? I don't think so. These people are elected. They have different philosophies, certainly different than mine, but it is the voters who send them in an increasingly divided electoral system. And as long as we're still doing that, then I think it's difficult to disparage their motives based on all 6,000 emails.
And Eric mentioned something that, frankly, I think we can all deplore, and that is making a decision on the spot at one of these conferences to change a course of litigation. I personally have certainly never done that, and my colleagues and former colleagues have not, to my knowledge. That was a surprising revelation that anybody would have even thought of doing that. Because if there has been a reaction, and there were a number, initially some angry reactions to the articles, and then I think some reflection that you better make sure, and I think this is true across the country and regardless of party, you better make sure before changing a position or taking one or authoring a letter. I think the General Pruitt's example here was taken, that lesson was taken very seriously by an awful lot of people around the country. And they now scrub everything that comes in for any metadata that might be involved that could have been from outside the office. But I think they do something else that most of us have done all the time, which is to make sure that whoever your staff attorneys are in that area get to review anything that you're thinking about doing, any letter you're thinking about writing. It slowed up the process, I can tell you that from somebody who works with a lot of AG's offices, because they're making sure. They always did it, most of them always did it, a few exceptions. But they're making sure now that the AGs that are doing the work every day get a hard look at it and opine on it before the AG makes a statement. The shoot from the hip tendency that may have been a little more prevalent before Eric's articles has definitely been suppressed.
So this brings us, I think, where we're headed is what do we do about all of this, right, to the extent there is a great deal of influence being brought to bear, to the extent, you know, AGs have the potential to do a lot of good, how do we harness, the question becomes, how do we harness the benefits of state prosecutors and state AGs while ensuring their independence? Because as Eric, I think, has uncovered right now, there is, in at least some areas, in at least some states, a lamentable lack of independence.
Well, let's start with something that's been said a bunch of times, and that is regulation. I frankly don't know what we're talking about. All attorney generals at the moment, even though it's not required in every state, are lawyers. And they are subject to the bar, and they're subject to bar discipline. And so there's a lot more regulation.
One's not a lawyer.
Well, and in Arizona, it's not required. You may be surprised at that, but you can. You don't have to be a member of the bar, and you don't have to be a lawyer. And it was a law professor that broke that bank because he wanted to be appointed attorney general, and he had not practiced law in 20 years. So nonetheless, most of them are lawyers, most of them are regulated by the bar. And the second shillabeth that I'd like to deal with is maybe they should all be appointed. And I think that would be a tragic move in the course of this kind of jurisprudence, because then they're a pawn, a agent of the governor. And the independence, which I think is one of the hallmarks of this particular area of public officials, is blown away. And you can start with something as simple as the Freedom of Information Act, where federal state agencies are usually the culprits, and it's the AG office, regardless of party, who's dealing with them at arm's length and as sometimes opponents. And they take them to court, and they fine them, and they make sure that journalists and others get access to that information. I think those are critical separations of power that we need to retain in state government.
I think lobbying is good. I think we need more of it. We need it by more people. And so anything that stands in the barrier between people and access to their own elected officials, I think, is bad. And I think lobbying at fundraisers is bad. It is very bad. Because I think lobbying is good and is inherently part of the public business, then I think it should be done in government offices. And that changes the whole tone, even if it's one-on-one, but it dramatically increases the chance that the staff people who were involved would be in the room. Frankly, that's how I did it. And so when I was AG, it was a long time ago, but that's what I insisted on. I no problem meeting someone socially, talking to them, listening to them, asking them for money. But if you want to talk about the case, you want to talk about business, it's a government function, it should be in a government office. And that's the way the world ought to work. It doesn't work. I think that's a serious problem. I think the national association should make it easier to have that happen. I've never been to a Raga Daga meeting, so I don't know. But I do think that CWAG, which is the Western AGs, and we have a special shout out to our friend Tom Getty here, who led that fine organization for years, but also NAG, who's had a series of outstanding leaders. NAG does not take corporate people. I think you should make those meetings more accessible. We had a NAG conference here at Stanford Law School. We had another one at Harvard Law School, which were fabulous. We were dealing with the rise of the internet. People came. It was substantive. You don't have to have it at a big fancy resort, and I think that would be important. If you have to have high registration fees, I think executive directors of these organizations should be allowed to waive the executive fees so we can get low-income people, so we can get homeless people, so we can get people who are the victims of crime. We can get them in the door and on the agenda of meetings, which for too often has a high fiscal count. So those would be my three. You didn't even ask. I couldn't wait. My three major reforms. I don't think passing lobbying registration doesn't work for congressmen. I don't think it's going to help. I don't think it's going to help here. I don't think it works. So, I'd be for it if it worked. I just don't think it works.
So Terry, one of the things you brought up is where is the bar disciplinary activity here if there's a problem? And some people have said that the one problem is the bar rules don't necessarily beautifully apply here, and that we actually need the ABA to adopt an enforceable code of conduct for state AGs, similar to the model code of judicial conduct. Is that something you would think has promise or not particularly?
I don't know. I'm not an expert on the judicial code. I think that our lawyers, I know, took very seriously their obligations to lawyer, the obligations of confidentiality, of client protection, and spent a lot of time, and this is always tough, as trying to decide exactly who is their client. Is it, the state versus an individual person or outside of the criminal context? That's sometimes a very tough thing to decide. and we spent a lot of time arguing and agonizing over that. But most of the things that I've heard today and in other contexts leveled against attorney generals, they and their assistants wouldn't think of doing if it violated the canons of ethics. I mean, you've got a pretty robust series of rules out there right now. I frankly don't think we need a whole lot more.
I mean, but again, look at what's the two former Utah attorney generals are under criminal indictment right now for money they took from the payday lending industry to try to influence the legislative process and the legal actions in the state of Utah. I mean, the Vermont attorney general is under investigation, is not running for re-election now, for taking money from a plaintiff's law firm shortly before he agreed to hire them on a contingency basis to sue oil companies for underground pollution. I mean, then of course you have the Texas and the Pennsylvania attorney generals who are also unrelated to their activities as attorneys general. So those are slightly different cases. But you've got four different, you know, states where either just departed or sitting attorneys general are actively under criminal investigation. I mean, that's extraordinary. I mean, these are the chief law enforcement officers. I mean, that's got to say that there's something weird going on in the world of state AGs to have that kind of thing happen simultaneously in the United States. And I mean, I think that I was amazed about what was happening at the beach villas at the Dell, at the Hotel Del Coronado, behind the key card only, you know, gate. The intensity of the camaraderie among the hired lobbyists, many of them former AGs, who now work for law firms representing the corporations, and the AGs sitting there in a 3-day weekend at a place that costs, and for most of the rooms, $4,000 a night. And talking for hours about all of their matters, 100,000 miles away from all their office staffs, and that kind of thing shouldn't be happening. I mean, if they want to have, you know, conferences, just, you know, they can have a conference where they can, you know, talk about, you know, public matters, but it should be about a conference in which everyone is invited, and it shouldn't be that if you pay $125,000, you can spend a 3-day weekend at the beach villas at the Dell with your corporate representative and the AGs. I mean, I do think that registration and helps, because I think it provides visibility. You at least know who they've hired, how much they're being paid, and what the issues are. And in most states, there is no registration by this whole world of lobbyists. And I do think in most states there aren't seen to be revolving door limits, where you can leave in Washington State, where you can leave and then several weeks later, all of your subordinates, who you just decided how much they're going to be paid, you can be lobbying them. That seems really weird. And so I think those are some changes that could occur that would, now it's not going to cure this problem. And I think that the fact that the attorneys general are more powerful and more prominent and they're taking up more cases that are of public good and importance is great, and the corporations are going to respond, you know, reflecting that expression of strength, and so it's not going to stop this lobbying, but at least it's going to bring greater transparency into it.
In terms of low-hanging fruit and policies to clean things up, am I right that only in some states do they ban campaign donations, even from a company that's actually actively targeted for
investigation? I don't think there's a ban in any state. I mean, in New York State and Missouri now, the attorneys general have voluntarily decided to not accept contributions from targets of active investigation. Mm-hmm. It seems pretty normal. I mean, you know, you're going to take hundreds of thousands of dollars from, you know, from the bank that you're actively investigating. That creates an appearance of a conflict of interest, even if there is none. Mm-hmm. But I asked Daga and Raga after my stories ran. I said, well, is there any consideration of when there's an ongoing multi-state investigation to stop, if it's a multi-state, you know, a good number of states are, and that means that there's the possibility that more states are going to join. And all of a sudden, if you look at these, who the new members are, a lot of the new members are the targets of multi-state investigations. It's not a coincidence that, you know, when there's new members suddenly. And no, Daga and Raga have decided not to stop taking, because that would wipe out most of their revenue. As far as I know, it's, I don't know what, I know of two states that, Terry, I don't know, do you know if there are more states where active investigations that the AGs don't take contributions from?
Everyone that I know of, as a matter of professionalism, does not take, I wouldn't have thought of taking a contribution from somebody who was being investigated or even under the possibility of investigation And that's generally the case. I don't know that there's a rule, because how do you know who's under investigation?
Right.
But an AG who takes that kind of a contribution, frankly, is a damn fool. Right. They not only run the conflict trap, but politically, that's dynamite. It's perhaps the worst thing an opponent can do to you is to say X, Y, and Z took a contribution right. from a company that they subsequently indicted or they let off.
But that's the problem with Dag and Rag.
That's the political consequence.
They're a great vehicle for the corporation to give a large contribution to, and then it gets spread.
CWAG has a different rule, which is you can object to a member, and if you think that they shouldn't be contributing to CWAG, the Western Attorney General's group, Tom Getty can speak for it, but it's basically a different rule. Even though I objected to a particular corporation being a sponsor, and I was only one of five, so I couldn't get them thrown off, even though I was the chairman at the time. So it's not perfect, but I think with Jim's point about having more transparency in the meetings, perhaps coming to law schools instead of coming to resorts is a good one. The idea of doing political fundraisers while you're having a group meeting, I think, ought to be considered and abolished. That didn't used to be the rule among the AGs, and I believe the only reason it changed is because of the amazing pressure. And let's get back to remedies that make a difference. At the bottom of all this is the corruption of huge amounts of campaign money that's flowed into this as well as others. RAGA was born after the success of the tobacco litigation. I mean, that's a cause and effect situation. Suddenly you had a group of AGs from the other side who got together and said, we've got to stop this. This is a runaway freight train. But that doesn't mean, and I think Jim's made this point, but I want to make it again, that there's some kind of an iron nexus or iron connection between people who are on that list and the way AGs act. Maybe they have a chance to make their case, as they would in court, as they would in the public forum. This is another shot. But it doesn't mean, and in many cases that I could give you quite a few, the AGs as a group or individually have gone in exactly the opposite direction. Lawrence Wasdin, for example, the AG of Idaho, recently settled a case with 5-Hour Energy, which is one of the people you pointed out as being a big sponsor of some of these areas. Lawrence sued him, and didn't hesitate for a minute. And I think that's far more the rule than it is the exception.
And you, I mean, Eric, let me just. All right.
Come on, Jim.
You go out and you pass yourself a law that says you can't take money from somebody under investigation. But you can take money from Company B, who's competing with Company A, all you want in order to get the AG to go after Company A. That's fine, right, with you, with that rule. So your rule, it doesn't work, does it? Okay? So the level of naivete from people who don't actually do it, and yet the impermissible implication in the world and the voice of journalism, that post hoc, ergo, propter, heck, there shouldn't be a lawyer in this room who isn't appalled by the implications that because an email is sent or a meeting was held or somebody visited, therefore that the attorney general of their state is corrupt. That is appalling. As lawyers, you cannot come to that conclusion. You do not know. You cannot know. I don't know. Terry doesn't know, because you don't know what the internal decision-making are. You don't know what the resources are. You don't know what the priorities are. You don't know any of those things. But to simply say that is, I think, preposterous.
All right. I think we're going to open it up to questions from the audience. And the
you
first,
have no choice.
Yes, and the first question will come from Ron.
I'll just take one. That may be preposterous. Is it preposterous if Mr. Pruitt took $100,000 from these people?
Oh, he did.
He took more than that.
Oh, he bragged about it.
Then it's not preposterous. Now, if what you're telling me...
He ran for office saying he was going to be the energy industry's best friend, and he won, and he is. So that's what we call democracy. It's one of the reasons I don't live in Oklahoma.
He didn't have, Jim, with all deference, he didn't have to take the money.
Now, no, he didn't have to, because he was on the polls last time around.
The notion of going after Eric because the one-sentence rule can be avoided. I can write a rule. It won't be perfect, but I can sure constrain it. So just the limits of draftsmanship isn't a risk.
That's back to dark money again. Terry, would you help these people? You and I talked about
trying.
This.
You're trying to write a rule to ban
them. You're living in a dreamland.
Short answer is, Jim, you ought to be waving a flag that says no contributions. Because as
from who for what? From who for what?
Well, under investigation, and the notion is, because we've got really terrific state assistant AGs, we can know, the AG can find out pretty quickly who's under investigation by his or her own.
Great, so you want to tip off the investigation by sending the money back? I actually was in that position. I actually got a check when I was running from a guy who was under criminal investigation. If I send the money back, I've just tipped off a secret investigation. Ron, you got to live there. You can't live here. You got to live there and have to make the hardcore decisions. And if you think you do it by rule, then you're in la-la land.
The response to Terry's concern that the demand for $6 million to run for attorney general is to at least constrain the worst parts of not taking some of that $6 million from people who are trying plainly to influence what your office is doing. The reason why I think you might want to be carrying a sign for this is because it generates precisely the reaction that you're correctly responding to, that somehow the AGs aren't doing in general spectacular work, doing work that nobody else can do, with talented people, and you're absolutely right, not enough of our students, which didn't used to be the case 20 years ago, are going into the state attorney.
No, they can't get hired.
Well, because it's hard.
Yeah, you got to be really good, and your students may not be good enough. That's the bottom line. Let's be real here.
Actually, my students here at Columbia,
I place my Harvard kids and my Columbia kids in AG offices. They don't get hired out of law school unless they're in the honors program. It takes 5 or 6 years of hard-nosed experience. And we've got people here from the California AG's office who can tell you who my students are in this state's office. And believe me, they're good, and they had a lot of experience. But it's hard to get in.
Absolutely.
Nobody out there is saying, oh, please send me somebody from Stanford, please, because they'll be so smart that it's going to change the quality of justice in my state. That's not the way it works.
Right. And the point of taking money, circumstances in which we're describing, which invites precisely the attack correctly, that you're responding.
So do you want them appointed? Would you like the AGs appointed?
I don't want them. Can I constrain who they take money from?
All right.
Well, how are you going to do that?
How are you going to do that?
A, most investigations are secret and should be.
That's a challenge.
Yeah.
Now, okay,
and what about Jim's proposition about the company that wants you to sue Microsoft? Is it wrong to take any contributions from them, too?
So if what we're saying is, the way you're framing it, is can I write a rule that will constrain this enough, though not perfectly, to reduce the pressure on AGs and to constrain some of the pressure from fundraising? I think the answer to that is yes, but the way to do it is by sitting down and trying. Jim runs a program at Stanford. At Columbia, rather, take a half a dozen kids, put them to work trying to draft something that'll work.
Write a rule that'll stop this.
I don't have to stop everything.
Yeah, but you better start here because you will never find out
you're
how
not
it
stopping
is writing
all right.
those checks.
We're going to continue this conversation after, but we have about 12 more minutes to ask questions from the audience. So if anyone has a question, please go to the microphone.
Great program, thank you. I'm Michael
Asbury. No, it isn't,
apparently.
No? No, okay. I'm Michael Asimov from Stanford Law School. I'd like to ask about a different issue related to what you talked about that's of interest to me, and it's in this area of who is the client of the Attorney General, and relates to this question of the desirability of the independent power base of Attorney Generals who are elected. So I'm interested in the situation in which the Attorney General is called upon to represent a state agency on judicial review, where the agency has taken a position, is being challenged on judicial review, and is represented by the Attorney General. At the federal level, the general idea is that your client is the agency, and you do what the agency wants, just as you would for a private client. I wonder how different it is at the state level, where the Attorney General doesn't work for the chief executive, but has an independent power base. How often does an agency, does the Attorney General feel free to take a position at variance with the agency who's being challenged on judicial review?
It happens a lot. To short circuit the answer, I have a whole failure to defend section with a lot of academic writing and so on it on my website. It usually happens where you can't see it, that the assistant AG or the AG brings the client agency and say, we can't do that, that's unconstitutional. There are other ways to do it. You're exceeding whatever the arguments are, and it usually happens in that context, so you don't see it. But that happens all the time.
It really does.
Actually, occur in practice
every day, every hour of every day. I just did a Huffington Post interview on this today about the Flint water issue. It happens every day.
I mean, I had to sit down with clients who were agencies and tell them, for example, in the case they've wanted to reach a settlement. They've been working. The governor was pushing them to get a whole layer of back litigation or actually regulatory demands off the table. And so, in my opinion, they were settling way too cheap. And we sat down with the agency director, who was also a lawyer, and screamed at each other for about 2 hours. And the only reason I prevailed, frankly, because you're not really in a power position there, they have the legislature behind him in most cases, is because in that case I had independent authority and I could have brought a case on my own and I didn't have to go to the agency. I had another one where we sued a landowner over an environmental issue, and wonderful case. We did jury research that came into the hundreds of millions of dollars in terms of damages. The guy had just destroyed a very large part of one of our central counties. And but as soon as the agencies had to ante up for the advanced costs, regardless of our jury research, they wanted to settle. And so a $100 million case was settled for $12 million because the agencies didn't want to continue to ante for it.
Great question.
But we also have capture, which is the other problem, that agencies always want to have their own lawyer. And so they're either trying to get the legislature to appropriate them for them, or they're trying to move the lawyer out of the AG's office into their physical constraints so that they'll be their person. And sometimes those lawyers are under a lot of pressure. Are they working for the boss in the AG's position, or are they working for the agency?
And you also have the issue, and I advise AGs on this all the time, there isn't an AG office in the country who can't do an A-plus on a case. But I advise them and say, you know, in your state, maybe 5 B-minus cases produce more justice than 1 A-plus case. Because you have to deal, if you follow me, you have to deal with the resources you have, your repeat relationships, in order to get where you want to go. Because AGs can't bring any of these big cases alone. They just can't. Right now, they have the good fortune of having the federal government, but in another administration, they won't. I don't know what they'll do. They may disappear.
Oh, thank you. It's pretty clear that in connection with Mr. Lipton's investigation, the various state public records acts played a very important role. My question is, to what extent were the availability of records either limited because of the unique status of the attorneys general as lawyers? And was there any particular effort to limit records because of that? And if so, did they succeed? And as a secondary question, to what extent has there been any effort to either enlarge or reduce the availability of records from various states' attorney general's offices?
I think that for the most part, I was asking for what I considered lobbying emails, as opposed to like criminal investigations or even ongoing civil investigations. And I explicitly knew that I was not going to get email correspondence relating to open investigations, and so I tried not to ask for those. And I think the thing was that my impression is that no one has ever done a broad open records request of correspondence between corporate lawyers and sitting AGs like I've done before, and I would suspect that the kind of correspondence that I found doesn't go on as much anymore, because no one had ever looked, and now that someone has, they probably don't write a lot of the same emails that they used to. And
change their server.
Yeah, right, they took it in-house. As to whether or not you could expect, I mean, I actually was quite impressed, for the most part, with the responsiveness of the states to my request. There were certain states that said, well, like New York State, until recently, the Attorney General's office had a policy of essentially deleting all emails after like 6 months, just out of course, unless they made an explicit effort to save correspondence. And there was, I think it was, maybe it was North Dakota as well, where basically they said, oh, we don't keep any of our email correspondence. But for the most part, the states did maintain it, and they were quite responsive. And as I said, the fact that they are the chief freedom of information officers of their state put a burden upon them to be responsive. So
absolutely, it did. And I think this is one of the hallmarks of the group, is they are the keepers of open meetings and public access to records. And I frankly was very impressed at how much you got. I know you're a great reporter and very diligent, but an awful lot of states did have to cooperate with your requests, which frankly got a lot of information in the New York Times that I'm sure many people would have much rather seen stay in their files. So I think that process works pretty well. And it works in large part because you have independent attorney generals who are the keepers of freedom of information, and they do their job. And I guess it's hard for them to do their job as to themselves, but hypocrisy being a cruel master, I think they managed to treat everybody equally in these cases, and have. You're the proof of that pudding.
Hi. Let's see. One of the stories that has attorneys general in the news a lot lately here is the whole daily fantasy industry. Daily fantasy
sports.
Sports betting. You know, you can assemble a team and bet all in a day. And so Texas today, the attorney general determined that it's illegal to do in Texas. The New York attorney general has done that. The Illinois attorney general. A lot of other states have come up. Regulation, although they haven't determined that it's illegal. So on the one hand, you have the attorneys general making these decisions. On the other hand, this is an industry that in a very short period of time has acquired, the two top companies have acquired over $1 billion in venture capital in a space of maybe 2 to 3 years. And so I'm just wondering, kind of looking ahead as opposed to looking at what's gone on in the past, given the vectors of forces that you're talking about here tonight, do you have anything that you would say about where this might go?
Yeah, well, first of all, I don't care about it personally. Just so you know, people want to go.
I don't either. But
I'm sorry, I'll just tell you. Secondly, if anything, it should give proof to the fact that notwithstanding my former, I was of counsel to Boies Schiller, notwithstanding the fact that it seems that, from what I hear, the entire Boies Schiller firm is litigating all over the country, notwithstanding the fact that the aforesaid J.B. Kelly is lobbying his hearts out for these people, it's not getting them anywhere. They've been able to bring together the Texas AG and the New York Attorney General. Now, that is sort of an extraordinary, extraordinary function. And it's because these assistant AGs, these minions, have researched the law, and they think it's illegal in this state. And that's what they think it is. And in Massachusetts, where they don't think it's illegal, they're trying to regulate it, which sounds like pretty sensible to me. But the other states, they don't have the regulatory authority. The industry is trying to point all the other AGs to Massachusetts, who has some very good common sense, no insider trading, professionals, non-professionals, all kinds of good regulations. But these other AGs say they don't have the authority to do that. It's either illegal or legal. And so if it's illegal, those AGs, notwithstanding all the lobbying in the world, they're going to enforce the law. Notwithstanding $1 billion, they're going to enforce the law. And I don't know. Each state's gambling laws are unique, so I don't know who's right or wrong. Well, I don't know if that helps or not, but that should be an example that all the lobbying in the world isn't going to get you out of it if it's illegal.
But your point is that there's an awful lot of money behind fantasy sports that should be getting a better result. Is that?
No. Personally, I don't think they should get a better result. The thing that strikes me is what I wonder is you have people, Robert Kraft, Jerry Jones, people who have a lot of money, who have a large public profile. Google has invested in these Time Warner, it's a long list of people who are very prominent. I can't believe that nobody anticipated this happening.
Oh, it's money. It doesn't surprise me. Industries take off all the time without thinking about state laws. They're often malpracticed by their law firms. The big law firms, because of the aforesaid, don't care about state law. They give them all the federal advice in the world, and they send themselves over the top. I just want to say something else as our time runs out. You know, let's go easy on the corporate guys. The biggest corporate defendant, since we're here in the Silicon Valley, of an antitrust case was who? It was Microsoft. And repeatedly, their general counsel and their CEO said states' AGs have no business in the world of antitrust law. Who are the people writing the letters here trying to get the Mississippi AG to go after Google? The same corporation. These guys, they're going to follow their own economic interests here. And their hatred of AGs turns into the love of AGs, depending on the issue. And that's okay. We're all adults here. We can figure this out.
All right, but the last question.
Hi, thank you. Your comments were actually timely because I was interested in your perspective on the corporate lobbying actions. We've talked a lot of it about this issue from your side and the AG side, but what about corporate culpability? We see increasing number of shareholder proposals that are getting more and more support from the shareholders wanting corporations to disclose where they're spending their lobbying dollars. And you've also mentioned this is one of the biggest issues.
I'm all for it. I think, but it does create an incentive for people to go private. They're not publicly traded companies. You've got dark money floating around. But I would, as a rule, we can write together on, which would have corporations disclose their lobbying and where it goes. I think it would be very helpful if they did. They don't.
And the SEC is considering that.
Yeah, and the SEC is on that. Considering it.
The SEC proposal has gotten more comments than any other proposal in the history of the agency.
Yeah.
Ooh.
And we'll have that be the last word. So thank you to Terry, Eric, and Jim, and thanks for having us.